We are delighted to have Madhulika Kandelwal as the moderator, because she herself is an expert on this community building of the Asian American community in New York City. Dr. Kandelwal is the director of the Asian American Center at Queens College and associate professor in Urban Studies Department at Queens College. She has recently published a book, Becoming Asian American, Being Indian. It's not recent, okay, I'm sorry. 2002, you're right. Okay. She has a PhD from history. She has a PhD in history from Carnegie Mellon. That's too much information. Am I oversharing? But I'm very proud to have her here, and she's always been a great supporter of AAARI and certainly of CUNY. Okay, Madhulika, take a look again.
Thank you, Frank, and thank you for being such a sport and cutting my long introduction, which is sometimes I just feel very embarrassed and reminded of things that I have forgotten sometimes. And I just want to say that I really feel indeed privileged to have this panel and to introduce the panel to you today. These people that you see here, I'm just going to do very, very brief introductions, basically give the names and the organizations that they're representing here. But it is amazing to have this group of people together. And very often I have wanted to talk to them and didn't get the opportunity to do that for probably a month, and years have passed by. So I'm personally very privileged to be here and to introduce you and to share this panel with you. And hopefully we are going to have a great discussion and to be continued later on outside of this conference in the months and years to come. So without further ado, I just want to remind you about the title of this panel, which is The New Asian American in New York City, Coalition Building and Community Empowerment. And we'll be following the sequence that's in the programs. We have Seema Agnani, who is Executive Director of Chaya CDC. Then Stephen Choi, Executive Director of Min Kwon Center for Community Action, formerly YCASEC. Wayne Ho, Executive Director, Coalition for Asian American Children and Families. Tiloma Jayasinghe, Executive Director of Sakhi for South Asian Women. Gurpal Singh, Executive Director of SEVA, Immigrant Community Advocacy Project. And it could be called an ED panel as well. And I really say that with a lot of seriousness, because to be an executive director of these organizations is more than the director's job. It's like really doing so much and challenging things every day. So it is really a great honor to have these people come away from their projects and their offices and the tireless work that they do to have a discussion with all of us. So thank you. I want to, you know, really have a round of applause for these people. And the format that we are going to follow is I'll be requesting each one of you to give opening remarks. You know, I'm just saying up to 5 minutes, around 5 minutes or so. And if you can respond to the topic itself, how you view it. The conference is about also the 2009 elections. So if you feel like making a reference to that, how significant that was and what bearing it would have for you or the organization that you're representing, that's perfectly fine. But it's up to you how you want to utilize these, you know, opening remarks. And then after that, we'll have a round of I'll probably pose a few questions, and then we'll open it to all of you to have a question and answer session. Thank you so much. So we'll start with Seema Agnani.
Thank you. Benefit of my A last name. good morning, everyone. Thank you to CUNY for having us and Madhulika for your generous introduction. So my name is Seema Agnani. I'm the executive director of Chaya CDC. Chaya was established, this is our 10-year anniversary. Our focus is on housing. We work primarily in Queens, northwestern Queens and southwestern Queens on issues of tenant rights. We do tenant organizing, homeownership education, and now much more foreclosure prevention. we work primarily, our target is really the South Asian community, including India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Nepal, and as well as those from the Caribbean, Guyana and Trinidad, the diaspora. Our community is extremely diverse, so is our staff, and so a lot of what our work involves is negotiating a lot of different ethnicities and cultures and communities, and so that's a very big part of how we approach our work. As of the 2000 census, South Asians made up the second largest Asian American ethnic group. It was at 271,447, to be specific. The majority of South Asians came to New York City after 1985, and so it's a fairly recent immigrant group, and we know that groups like the Bangladeshi community, and I'm sure we'll see in this census the Nepali, Tibetan community as some of the fastest growing new groups. because of the recent arrival to New York City, South Asians live in some of the most overcrowded conditions among many ethnic groups. New York City has been in a housing crisis since the 70s, so having been more recently arrived, many people live in informal housing, shared housing units, and the like. As Glenn pointed out earlier, there are issues. 30% of Bangladeshi and Pakistani immigrants live in poverty, and about 40% have limited English proficiency among Bangladeshi and Pakistani. I think for the Indian community, it's about 30% as well. Our mission is to create stable and sustainable communities by increasing civic participation and addressing the unique housing and community development needs of South Asians, new immigrants, and their neighbors. I read the mission because I want to point out that civic engagement is a really core part of our work, and we see it as a critical part of any approach to community development. A lot of people see CDCs as doing bricks and mortars, but civic engagement is really a core part of that work. In most of the projects that we work on, we need the support of elected officials, we need the support of community boards, and we need the community to push for those strategies. And so civic engagement becomes key. We still lack representation on all levels of government, as we know. We're making progress, but on the city level, on the state level, all the way to the Senate, South Asians are still very much underrepresented. And so to address this issue for the last few years, Chaya has really spent a lot of time trying to build up its capacity in civic engagement. We've been doing voter registration, taking cues from some of my colleagues here on the panel. We started to build a database of voters. I know that Ming Kwan has been doing that for a long time, and that's really given us a lot more credibility in the community to have an ongoing list of people that we can call before elections occur and remind them that these elections are happening, this is what's at stake. We've been engaging more on the community board level. We've been just going to community board meetings. There's a real lack of presence of immigrants at those community board meetings, and particularly around land use issues, community boards have a lot of power, and so that's something that we're thinking about now, is how to get more of our community members on community boards. We helped to organize a candidate forum with coalition partners. A lot of the South Asian groups came together in this last election and organized one of the first candidate forums in Jackson Heights that was really targeted to the South Asian community. And Seva was part of that. Saya, it was a group. Most of the South Asian groups that work in that area were there. And it was really a historic event, I feel, that we were able to bring the candidates to our community, pose questions that were important to us, and I think really made sure that the candidates felt accountable to the South Asian community. And so in the end, I feel that we really did have an impact on that race, and the candidate who did win, Councilmember Drum, he does deserve credit because he really made an effort to reach the South Asian community and continues to do so today. So that was the main thing. In the last election, we worked with ALDEF on that polling project, which was also very helpful to get a sense of talking to voters. So our plan is to continue to build on this. During the census, we actually continued to work with a lot of those South Asian groups, Adhikar, SACS, SAYA, and SEVA, and CHAYA. We all came together and launched a campaign to make sure that the South Asian community participated in the census. And I looked through our report yesterday, and as of the middle of our campaign, between all these groups, we reached 50,000 people. This was through community events, faith-based institutions. That doesn't even include the media work, which would probably broaden it to another 100,000. So this is where CHAYA is at with these elections, and we hope to build and learn from our partners and work together in building that power.
Thank you, everyone. My name is Stephen Choi. I'm the executive director of the Ming Kwan Center for Community Action, formerly YCASEC, the Young Korean American Service and Education Center. Just spent a lot of breath talking about our organization's name. So we've actually been around for 26 years. We originally started as YCASEC in Jackson Heights in 1984. And at the time, we focused very much on social services for recent Korean immigrants and also education for young Korean Americans. And then over the course of the next 25 years, our mission changed actually quite a bit. And so we started to expand. And so now we have programs in advocacy and community organizing, in social and legal services, civic participation, and youth empowerment. So I won't bore you, and I'll skip to the civic participation part. So we, along with CHAYA, I think we feel that civic engagement and making sure that the community members that we work with, the first generation immigrant community members from Korea, we want to make sure that they are engaged in the civic process. Too often, because of lack of cultural familiarity or lack of language access, they just feel like they are completely disengaged from the process. And so, you know, we've seen, especially in Flushing and in Jackson Heights and Corona and Elmhurst and the places where our community members live, there really is a lack of accountability on the politicians, the local politicians. You know, a place like Flushing, I mean, even back in 2000, I'm sure some folks remember, the city councilwoman Julia Harrison referred to Asians as invaders and, you know, other sorts of very unflattering terms. And so, you know, I think it really illustrated the fact that although the numbers are growing, there was no political weight to really match that. So our civic participation program is a comprehensive program that is designed to engage these folks into the civic process from beginning to end. So voter registration, we really focus a lot on voter registration. We'll do street outreach drives. We'll go down to the courthouse and get people right when they're naturalized. We'll actually hand out voter registration forms at the naturalization ceremony. And so when folks come out, we'll just be like, hey, you're excited to be a citizen, fill this out. And we get about 100, 150 every time. So since 2004, we've ended up registering more than 40,000 new immigrant voters. So once you register the voters, then you've got to really educate them. So for the course of that, we also do candidate forums. Last year, we did a candidate forum in Flushing for District 20 city council candidates. And that was at the Flushing Library. We had 300 people. It was standing room only. I mean, it was people tried to say, oh, Steve, can you get me in? I was like, this isn't a club. There's no, like, you know, there's nothing like that. I can't get you in like that. But, I mean, the voter, that was actually the only nonpartisan candidate forum in Flushing that actually talked about Asian American issues. It's the only one. They had a bunch of candidate forums, but a lot of them were really boring and weird. So I think, you know, ours was really, you know, I think it served a very important community purpose. We also put together a lot of bilingual voter materials. We'll send out postcards. You know, so education is obviously crucial, but really what we focus on is mobilization. I mean, you can educate the heck out of people, you can send them whatever you want, but if they don't show up to the polls, And you look at statistics, people don't really show up to the polls that much. I mean, you know, last year the voter turnout in the city was like a record low. I forget what the number was, but,
11%,
you know.
11%, I think.
11%?
Yeah,
wow.
That
really?
Yeah.
I mean, it's really shocking. And especially for Asian American community members who are limited English proficient and are, you know, getting a lot of materials in the mail in English saying, you got to vote, do this, do that, but they have really have no idea what these things mean. So voter mobilization is a huge focus of what we do. We do phone banking. We end up usually calling up to 5,000 voters, you know, before the election, reminding them to vote. We actually launched the first door knocking effort, the first nonpartisan door knocking effort in Flushing back in 2008, where we went out to people's doors. We knocked on nearly 1,000 doors to remind people how to vote and also to ask them what their opinions were. And, you know, it was really the first time that folks had done that, you know, a community organization had gone out and done that. And, you know, I think that before that, people were like, oh, you know, Asians don't like people coming to their doors. You know, Koreans don't like people, strange people coming to their doors. But we found that, if anything, it was the opposite. People were tickled pink that someone was asking their opinion in their language about some of these issues. It was a, you know, I mean, they weren't used to that. So we found the reaction was really favorable to that. So I think that is really the focus of what we do, this kind of voter mobilization, this direct grassroots contact with community members. And I think that's an approach that we used also for the census as well this past spring. Flushing is the place where we are. I mean, it's an extremely important political seat for Asian Americans. It featured the first ever Asian American elected official in the city in John Liu back in 2001. It also featured the first ever state Asian American elected official. Who was it? Jimmy Meng. It was Jimmy Meng. It was Jimmy Meng, Grace Meng's father. And then after that, it was Ellen Young. And then now it's Grace Meng. And I can't believe I'm forgetting this stuff. But don't tell Grace. It's just an absolutely important political seat for Asian Americans. And I think a lot of people see it as probably the preeminent Asian American political district in the city. Now, of course, you know, Margaret Chin has been elected for city council in District 1, and so I think that there's other definitely pockets and communities that are starting to rise up. But I think Flushing historically has been an extremely important place, and I think District 20, you know, in the city council is very important. And for us last year, it was definitely a very interesting time because our board president S.J. Jung was running for city council in District 20. And so it was interesting because on one hand, it really is the fulfillment of a lot of the civic participation work that we do, in the sense that, you know, through this voter work, you want to sort of build a base of empowered community members who are going to really be active and pushing progressive political stances. And, you know, I think that a lot of nonprofits have thought maybe we should create a C4, maybe we should create a PAC. Because, I mean, you know, this whole sort of artificial distinction that nonprofit organizations can't support candidates or can't support policies, I mean, it's very artificial because you can sit there and you can say, you know, we support this and, you know, this needs to be done, and but there'll be a candidate, but you can't say, well, we support this candidate too, who also is really into this particular issue. So I think a lot of nonprofits are thinking, they were thinking and they continue to think, maybe we should create C4 so that you can have a related entity that's going to say, please support this candidate because this is the right person to represent this district. But we didn't have a C4, and so it was a tricky situation because, you know, we didn't want people to accuse us and say, oh, you know, you guys are really supporting S.J. Jung. And, you know, like when we had the candidate forum for District 20, we were the main ones who were organizing it. And some of the other candidates, you know, they cast some aspersions on us saying, you know, and I think there are a lot of people who are saying, oh, you guys are going to, you know, somehow craft the questions to favor, you know, SJ and things like that. I don't know exactly how you would do that, but, you know, there are a lot of people who raised serious questions about that. So it was a tricky thing for us, I think. And and I think sort of walking that line, tiptoeing that line between, you know, committing a legal violation, but also, you know, continuing to do our part in terms of educating our community members, I think that was really sort of an interesting thing for us. And thankfully, nobody from our organization is running this fall, so I don't think we have to worry. But I do think that it illustrates there were a lot of interesting things that came out, a lot of generational things. I mean, one thing, you know, like I feel that there is this conflict between this first generation idea that says basically get blank ethnicity politician elected. You know, there are people who said we need to get a Chinese Chinese politician. We need to get a Korean city council member. And I think that has been the way of thinking for a lot of sort of, I don't want to call it first generation, but maybe like, I don't know exactly how you call it, but that's been the way of thinking for a lot of folks for a long time. We need to get, we're going to be so proud when we get a Korean on the city council. The problem is that in the future, last year and in the future, I mean, people would come up and say, are you supporting the Korean candidate in the election? I'd say, which one? Because there's more than one. You know, people would say, we need to get a Chinese person. Well, there are three Chinese candidates last year. So I think that as a community, we need to move past that sort of first-generation thinking. And instead of saying we need to get this person, a Korean or a Chinese or a South Asian or whatever, instead of thinking that way, I think we need to start to move away and think about politics and policies. Obviously ethnicity plays a huge role. There's no denying that. But I think that moving forward, it's not going to be as simple as simply as saying, you know, we need to get a Chinese person or a Korean on the city council. So,
thank you so much.
Morning. How's everyone doing?
Good.
Good. Thanks. Is this mic even on?
Yeah.
All right. No? You can hear. All right. So CACF, the Coalition for Asian American Children and Families, we're a 24-year-old pan-Asian children's rights organization here in New York City. We are actually the nation's only pan-Asian children's rights organization. So we are an advocacy organization. We go to elected officials, to appointed officials, to make sure there's better policies, funding, or services for Asian Pacific American children and families. With that background, I have two questions for everyone here. First question is, how many city council members are there in New York City, total?
Are we allowed to answer?
No, you guys can answer.
No.
We all work together. You can't answer. 51.
Really?
Yes. Second question, how many state senators and state assembly members are there? Total.
One of them is 62.
There is 62 of one.
That's a response, sir.
There's still a question. Good question, right?
There's 212. So do the math. One assembly member who is Asian out of 212 state elected officials, and then two out of the 51 are Asian, Chinese, in the city. As a quick side note, by the way, Robert Jackson happens to be half Chinese. It only comes out when he speaks at Asian events, though. I like Robert Jackson and his politics.
And he's a Muslim.
He is?
Seriously.
Yeah. He's a Muslim. He is.
Yeah. Yeah. Robert Jackson.
So the reason I bring this up is that if we hinged all our beliefs on improving the well-being of the Asian American community on Asian politicians only, we're not going to get very far in terms of promoting the rights and advancing the rights and social justice for our communities. So is it good to have more Asian elected officials? Yes. Is it good to have elected officials that are representative of the diversity of New York City and New York State? Yes. Is that what we need in order to promote justice? No. If that was the case, we would never have been able to promote justice in different ways. Could it be easier? Maybe. If you are the only Asian American or two of the Asian American city council members, you should represent your constituents. There's no doubt about that. But we have to consider the fact that if we are expecting Asian American elected officials to only and always represent the Asian American community, they're going to lose a lot of their political capital, and we're not doing our jobs. So this ties into the work that we try to do at CACF, is that we are there to advocate for the Asian American community, specifically children and families issues, but we have to talk to all 212 state assembly members and senators. We have to talk to all 51 city council members. We need to talk to the mayor's office. We need to talk to people on the executive side. And the reason I bring that up is because it's true. Everything that Glenn said earlier, everything that Seema and Steve said earlier is true, that there's still all these beliefs that we're perpetual foreigners, we're the model minority, and we don't have needs. And when we look at trying to advance policies, a lot of that comes down to what are they really taking into account the diverse immigrant and... That's Robert Jackson calling now. I called him out. We have to keep in mind linguistic needs and cultural needs and immigrant needs facing our community. So at CACF, I think regardless of whether you're the Asian elected official or the non-Asian elected official, we use the same strategies. We're there to hold you accountable to representing your community members. We're there to make, we do legislative visits and we talk to you and we bring our community members to meet with you. We have press conferences, we do community briefings, community forums. We write lots of letters to you to hold you accountable to make sure what you're doing is advancing things for who our constituents are. So at CACF, a lot of the work that we do is building a coalition of a pan-Asian coalition of different Asian American organizations here in New York City. So we currently have about 45 member agencies who, three of the four colleagues I have up here are member agencies right now. I'll talk to you later.
I got your email.
You got my email. We'll talk. Always working. I think the work that has to be done is that we can show up and say, hey, we represent the Asian American community, but it's more powerful for us to say we have 45 member agencies that employ thousands of New Yorkers and serve tens, if not hundreds of thousands of New Yorkers. And these tens of thousands of New Yorkers, we and the nonprofits that serve them happen to be an economic driver, we happen to be your constituents, we happen to be your voters, and we happen to be workers here in New York. And we all have the same interests as many New Yorkers, but there's specific ones that represent our community. So one key thing during this economic downturn is that Asian Americans were 12% of the community here in New York, of the population, but we get less than a quarter of 1% of all city social service contract dollars. So right away, any budget cuts will disproportionately impact our community. So the Minquan Center and CACF, we lead the 12% and growing coalition, which is to fight for fair state and city budgets during these tough times. And we have an advocacy day, by the way, coming up on Tuesday, May 18th. So if you haven't signed up for it or you want to come out for the activities, please come out. But I think the reason I bring this all these things up is that while it's true that we need to do more civic engagement, we need to do political education, we need to mobilize people to vote for the candidates that they want to be in office to represent their interests, it's not just about getting officials into office that look like us and understand us. It's about us working with all elected officials to hold all of them accountable in order to advance the rights of our community. And I think that's where, if you haven't picked up the phone lately or written a letter lately to your elected officials to fight for what you want during these hard times, then I encourage everyone here to do so. And I think as much as nonprofits, we're not allowed to get involved on supporting candidates or supporting political parties, nonprofits can do lobbying and push for policies and legislation and funding that we do want to see. So for any of you here that are related to nonprofit organizations, we hope that you continue to advocate for your community. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Thank you for having me. I told everyone before I started that I wasn't here. I wasn't the executive director of SUCCI during the 2009 elections, although I did do the polling with ALDEF. I just thought I'd talk a little bit more about the issues, like issues-based coalition building and community empowerment. I know everyone here does that, and you're all talking about the civic and engaging with political participation, but I just wanted to show how it looked in the life of the population I work with. SUCCI for South Asian Women is an anti-domestic violence organization, and we focus on women from the South Asian diaspora, including the Indo-Caribbean community. We help anyone that comes through our doors or calls through our helpline, but we focus on that population. And they are nowhere even near thinking about voting, political participation. They're facing so many multiple oppressions that it's a lot of work that we do to bring them to that level of understanding where they fit in the larger political process, how what they need and what they want requires some of that civic engagement. But I just want to tell you a story, because that's how I talk, so I don't sound like a a machine. There's a recent immigrant. Her name is Sunita. Everything is made up. She comes to the U.S. after being sponsored by her husband. She was raised in... I'm Sri Lankan, so she's Sri Lankan. Let's say she's Tamil, so she is actually escaping violence in her home country as well. She gets an arranged marriage here. She's not English proficient in English at all. She has no idea about this country, and she goes to live in Staten Island. When she gets here, her husband isolates her. He rations her food. He doesn't let her go out. He controls her every movement. She's also experiencing abuse and control from her mother-in-law and from her brother-in-law, because that's how family violence looks like in our communities. It's not just intimate partner, it's also family. The family threatens her with deportation or jail, sending her back to a country that's been ridden with ethnic conflict for years if she speaks out to anyone. And she's not allowed to work, they say, and quite rightly, she's not allowed to work under an H-4 visa. But, you know, they're using that as a sense of control. So she is more a slave than a wife. So the only place that she is allowed to go to is her temple. But the priests there aren't very helpful. They're not the people that she can go to, and she doesn't feel comfortable speaking out in her community. Her one friend that she has said, listen, you have no options. There's no one here to serve you. You better just stay and keep your head down just so that the violence doesn't increase. She wants to learn English. She wants to have a job. She wants to leave. Once she becomes pregnant, the violence escalates, and she's finally instigated to do something, and she runs away. And maybe through the police, maybe through a friendly neighbor, maybe through some sort of connection, she gets referred or gets sent over to Safe Horizon. They have no Sinhala or Tamil speakers at Safe Horizon, and then so they refer her to Seki, because they expect that we do. And actually, we don't have currently on staff a Sinhala or Tamil speaker. We haven't done any outreach that I know of in Staten Island. And of the over 700 calls we had last year, only 7 of them came from Sri Lanka. We serve India immigrants and women from India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Afghanistan, Sri Lanka, Indo-Caribbean community, but we haven't really done enough targeting in these populations. So that's just an aside I'm telling you. What issues are we presented with when we respond to the needs of this woman? Definitely immediate crisis prevention. We want to get her services. We want to get her support. But if we're really going to try and eliminate violence against women, if we're really going to try and stop this from happening, we have to address the causes and the consequences of it. And that's why it's so important to have coalition building and community engagement, because those are part and parcel of how we work to end violence. She's presenting us with immigration issues. I am a lawyer. I have no idea about immigration law. I'm definitely going to contact one of my partners here. Gurpal, right here, maybe. When she goes to court, if she decides to go to court for orders of protection or something, I will bet you $1 million that they will not have a translator for her in the language that she needs. So either we will have to provide one with her, or we will have to liaise with our partners to do that. We are micro-staff. We don't have the budget and the funding. We have to work together in order to handle all her needs. ESL training, shelter, job assistance, I'd be calling Chaya. All of the responses that this one woman needs requires a coalition effort. Therefore, when I advocate, when I talk about these issues, I'm never saying Sakhi does this. It is Sakhi along with all these partners, not just within the South Asian community, not even just with the Asian community, but with women's rights, with immigration rights, with women of color, of no matter what color, with the ESL movement also, the LEP, eliminating barriers to limited English proficient individuals also incorporates the needs of the deaf community. This is a very intertwined rope I'd like to be able to pull on to help provide services to this woman. And when we talk about preventing violence and addressing it in the community, we have to have the community participation. We need to have their buy-in. That's where anything will come. It won't come from outside imposed on anyone. It has to come from within. Why is it that this woman didn't feel safe speaking out in her community? Is it because they didn't know that there were referral mechanisms? Is it because it is a thing that we have that is silenced? You don't talk bad of your family. You don't bring this up in public. Is it because of the repercussions that she fears will happen if she calls the cops or anyone? Maybe she doesn't want her husband deported. She doesn't want to be deported. She's afraid from her own safety in this country. Remember, she's coming from Sri Lanka, where we've just come out of, 20, almost 30 years of violence, intra-community violence. These are all the issues that we deal with one woman from one country in one story I'm telling you. And the stories of the women that we respond to range so much more widely. So that is why we go out into the community and we talk about these issues in a multidimensional and holistic way. We also get pushback because we get talked about as housebreakers, as opposed to trying to improve what a family life should look like for all women and all men and their children. So that I require working with these guys who are talking behind my back. No, it requires...
Literally.
Doing it. They know the political leaders. I personally haven't had the time to engage with them as much as I could, but I can liaise with Wayne Ho to be like, do you know someone?
Yes.
You know, I serve over 100 women in District 30, you know, randomly. You know, who's the head of... How do I approach him? Like, I can talk about issues. So I'll talk more about this if you like later on, but this is how it looks in the life of my work. This is what it means on a day-to-day level. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
So my name is Gurpal Singh. I work with an organization called SEVA, Immigrant Community Advocacy Project. We are a community-based organization. I mean, I'm honored to be at this table because we're fairly new. We're only about 5 years old, technically. You know, I've been around in the community that we're based in, you know, for 25 years and started doing some work. But formally, the organization started about 5 years ago. We're based in South Queens in generally a neighborhood called Richmond Hill. It's an immigrant community, largely South Asian and West Indian. There's also a new crop of South American immigrants coming in. So it's an immigrant community. It was an old... an Italian community for a long time. The Gaddis lived in that area. I remember when I was growing up, there used to be huge Italian fairs, and the Gaddis used to do this whole firework show on 4th of July. You know, now it's almost, you know, there's really no, you know, quote-unquote white people left in the area. It's mostly immigrants of some kind, right? Some kind of an immigrant there. So I started working for an organization in 2000 called Acorn, you know, the infamous. It technically doesn't exist anymore, and I was an organizer in neighborhoods like Bed-Stuy in East New York and Far Rockaway. Poor black communities is what they had me organizing. And I did that for a number of years, and every night after work, I would go home to Richmond Hill and say, you know what, somebody needs to do this kind of organizing in this neighborhood. And I went to a number of people, and no one's really interested, and was forced, you know, to start an organization that would do very similar work. So we model ourselves off of the kind of organizing work that Acorn does, or did. So, you know, as far as, you know, we started with the idea of empowerment and coalition building in the community, right? So I would go to meetings, or I would go to an event, and it would be all one ethnicity. It'd be all Guyanese people. And I'd go to another event, you know, the next day, and it's all, you know, Punjabi Sikhs. And then, so, you know, the community itself wasn't, there was no coalitions, organic coalitions in the community at all. So if we don't have organic coalitions in the neighborhoods, you know, we can forget about really building powerful coalitions at a broad level, at the city level, at the state level. I mean, you can have these quote-unquote sort of coalitions that John Liu put together, but those aren't real coalitions. I mean, he was just able to pull votes from South Asians and Asians and Latinos and blacks, and they called it the sort of, you know, his, you know, coalition that he put together, but it was sort of superficial. You know, you go back into those communities, mm-hmm. and those coalitions don't exist, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, our initial work is about getting people together in the same room, right? That's generally what we try to do. Get people from the neighborhoods into the same room. Whatever product that we're selling, it really doesn't matter. Right? If it's the census, if it's voter reg, if it's, you know, some community issues, those are sort of, you know, just products that we use to get people in the room. And once they're in the room, once this sort of diverse body is in the room, we begin talking about everything, including politics. And, you know, I definitely think that, you know, this is hopefully not offending the next panel at 1:20, but, you know, politicians are overrated. You know, the elections are generally overrated, you know, and you know, if you can elect whoever, and you know, like Wayne was saying, one city council person is not going to change the structural issues in immigrant communities. You know, electing one, you know, Chinese immigrant, you know, to the city council is not going to really do much. It'll help. All right. So the real work has to be done by the communities, right? The real work, the real sort of change, structural change that we're looking for in generally working class immigrant communities has to come from the communities. It's not going to come from elected leadership or some national organizations coming in and they can help. I mean, unless you have natives, unless you have community people working and putting things together and figuring out, you know, what's needed and working with each other, there's no real, you know, change. And I think, you know, even with the election of Obama, there was this sort of, you know, God has arrived, we've elected Obama. But, you know, what, you know, there's still, his coalition fell apart, essentially. Like, he's begging everyone to come back together for 2010. So his, you know, those kinds of political coalitions are not very organic at all. You know, coming around once every 4 years to vote for the same person is not real in-depth work, right? It's not what's needed at the ground floor in these communities like Richmond Hill and places like Jamaica and Ozone Park and Woodhaven. You know, these communities are, you know, one example of the sort of issues that are being dealt with in the community is the neighborhood of Richmond Hill and Ozone Park is gerrymandered into 7 assembly districts, right? So, I mean, I know Glenn knows all about this, and we've talked about this. So that neighborhood, that community, it's a community of interest, right? It's generally immigrants, South Asian, West Indian, right? That neighborhood is chopped up into 7 assembly districts. Now, you know, it doesn't really matter who the, because each assembly district has about 3% of the neighborhood, or 4% of the neighborhood, or 8% of the neighborhood. I live on a block where, you know, one of the founders of Seva lives across the street from me, Sharon Carr. She lives in one district, I live in another. Right? And we live across the street from each other. We can't even vote for the same person. Right? So, you know, if she ran for office, I couldn't vote for her. So, you know, part of why we're doing the census work is to get these numbers up. You know, and we've been working on the census for about over a year, just to boost the numbers. And, you know, boost the numbers for redistricting, but also, it was a really good product to network in the community, right? Meet new people in the neighborhoods. Build these sort of organic community coalitions that are needed for, you know, kind of services that, you know, a battered woman would need. So, you know, maybe this one temple head person is not going to help her, but another temple head might in a temple that she doesn't go to. And so how we started organizing is we went from temple to temple, from mosque to mosque, from church to church in the neighborhood. And those were the only organic institutions that were there, right? There were no real powerful nonprofits or powerful civic groups. You know, there was no such thing. Even the community boards were filled with, you know, no offense to anyone, very old people who had nothing better to do, you know? And they were not interested in sort of the real issues in the community. They were very interested in hobnobbing with the elected officials that would come by, you know, every other month, yeah. Right? And so we realized that very quickly. So, you know, we worked with whatever existing, you know, infrastructure that there was in the neighborhood, generally religious institutions. We'd go and meet with them and figure out, you know, what their concerns were and try to get them in the room with some other temple people down the block. And, you know, with the Hindu temple guys, to sit with the Sikh temple guys, to sit with the mosque leaders and figure out, you know, solutions to the community, and then maybe invite an elected official over to, you know, just for picture's sake, right? But, so there is, you know, the real coalition building has to be at the organic level in neighborhoods, right? And here's the other issue that we deal with now. We also do a lot of work. I mean, we've done you know, we started with doing voter registration. We started doing with candidate forums, and we did a candidate forum in another South Asian community in North Queens called Belrose. It's a sort of upper middle class South Asian community. Richmond Hill is a working class South Asian community. They don't actually like hanging out with each other, you know, and the issues are very different, you know, and the kind of organizing work we do in Richmond Hill, you can't really go and do it in a upper middle class South Asian community. They're just not interested, you know. And what they're interested in places like Belrose are purely politics for identity's sake, right? You know, something that was talked about earlier, they want to elect a South Asian. You know, they want to elect a South Asian. Why? Because they're having their own identity crisis. You know, they've been in this country 30 years, they've made a lot of money, you know, they live in this South Asian community. But, you know, how are we representing, you know, this is quote-unquote, how are we representing our community to the broader public, you know, to the city as a whole? And I think there's a lot of identity crisis. And I think they use politics, a lot of the sort of upper middle class people use politics as a way to identify themselves in communities. Whereas in places like Richmond Hill and other communities, it's real issues that are at stake. You know, are we getting services? No. You know, are there real senior centers, after school programs that are really effective? No. You know, so
okay.
we'll go on.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks. Yeah. Thank you so much, Gurpal. We have limited time, and I want to get more out of you folks, really. So there's a lot that has been said, and there's a lot that you can make out from this. You know, I just want to mention a couple of things which I think is just absolutely stunning and brilliant for the sake of the discussion, right? That we are talking about Asian Americans and empowerment, but we're also talking about larger issues or deeper issues as well, right? So we have talked about the potential, but also the limitations of ethnic-based kind of work that we do. And we all have, I mean, you all have ethnic communities that we are talking about, you know, whom we feel responsible for and we want to help out. But also, there is a kind of going beyond those kind of boundaries, ethnic boundaries as well, that we are talking about. Incidentally, I want to mention that for those of you know, but we talk about South Asian community, for example, as one community. And right away, you can see we are not talking about one community here, right? And I believe in almost every ethnic group, the large, you know, ethnic-based identities have so many different populations and groups that have very different needs and very different interests as well. So I think we need to think about that and also think about, in a way, beyond Asian American as well, for the empowerment of Asian Americans. You know, how can we go beyond that? That's one thing I wanted to mention. The other thing is about, I think, the significance, and not only significance, but almost like necessity to really think about the grassroots organizing, the community organizing, as opposed to, you know, kind of representation at the top. And what's that? Because if you look at the title of the thing, it's about the new Asian American. Okay, so we're also talking about new ways of breaking ground again and again about what is community empowerment, right? And I think it would be great if we can really think about, not the panel, but, you know, all of us really think about the ways that we can move forward and not perpetuate some of the old traps even, you know, of ethnic-based politics and those kind of things. And it is a very diverse population we are talking about here, right? So where are Asian Americans in the larger kind of, like, diversity as well? You know, if you can think about that. And one which is very obvious from here is that there is, if not a coalition, at least a networking among these organizations. And I don't want to say this in a derogative way, but I really mean that these organizations are not very huge in terms of the resources. You know, and some of us are, like, really struggling with that kind of a thing. And yet the work that they are doing is not based on, like, individual resources, but on the synergy that we can hopefully create and make change from that real meaningful change, right? So I just wanted to mention a couple of things like this, and then ask the panel to respond to how much do you think is this new Asian American, or what could be the new, potentially, the new Asian American empowerment we are talking about? Is this new, or is it the same thing that we have been doing for I won't even say decades, for probably centuries.
I think it's new. I think I'm very impressed by what the panelists have been saying, and I think it is a new philosophy. It is a new way of thinking about it, you know, thinking about the issues and organizing around issues and not falling into this trap of, you know, electing somebody that looks like us. And I think that is a sort of new thing, and it's impressive to hear.
Mm-hmm. So. Okay. Anyone else?
Well, I mean, I think just by virtue of the next generation, you know, I was born in the U.S. I don't know about the rest of the panel, but I think that younger leadership is emerging. There is a different way of approaching this work and a deeper understanding, I think, of You know, I think the initial generations who came to the U.S. have actually been fairly engaged. It's just that I think the next generation is growing up in these communities and is much more integrated in many ways. And so that brings out new ways of approaching the work. Mm-hmm. But the other thing is that our communities are constantly changing, right? I mean, what is new in Jackson Heights? New is Nepali, Tibetan immigrants, you know? Mm-hmm. So in that sense, it's, you know, it's very fluid.
Yes, thanks. Anybody else wants to respond to that? No? do you think there's a coalition building going on among Asian American organizations, different Asian American organizations?
Yes.
Yes, Gurpal is there.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Seema with Chaya, and you know, we've been working with, experimenting with all kinds of different ways of getting other organizations together. I know Wayne literally did shoot me an email the other day, and so you know, there's definitely a movement towards building coalition. It's the only way to go, right? It's the only real strategy that's going to work. There's really no other way around it. I mean, unless we can join forces and put our little bits of resources together, you know, there's no other way to really create structural change, right, in community. There's no other way around it. And unless, if we fail at building these coalitions, even at the community level, we're not going to really be successful in much.
Please go ahead.
I mean, we're talking about coalition building at the organizational level, though. And I think that's a big difference between building coalitions or ties among Asian New Yorkers. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, something to think about is that it's true what Seema said. The Asian American community is always changing. And a lot of that is driven by immigration. According to 2000 census, 78% of all Asian New Yorkers are foreign-born. According to 2006 American Community Survey, 73% of Asian Americans are foreign-born. So while we're growing really fast, 3 out of every 4 of us are still foreign-born. And I don't know how many Chinese people see their lot tied in very closely to Filipinos, or tied in closely to Indians, or tied in closely to Indo-Caribbeans, or tied in closely to Japanese. And I think that's where, even when we walk around saying things like Asian or APA or Pan-Asian and these things, like that's at our level of the people in here. Yep. I can't necessarily say like every restaurant worker I go talk to, or every cab driver I go talk to, or every laundromat I drop in, just to use the stereotypical jobs. that when I go talk to them, that they see that there's truly this Asian identity or Pan-Asian identity. Yep. And I think a lot of it also is like, at some point, like they see themselves, or I would argue that many of them see themselves like, we're just New Yorkers who do care about, why is it MTA is getting so expensive? How do we pick up trash? Mm-hmm. Like, they're not necessarily there fighting just for Pan-Asian issues or racial justice issues or immigrant issues all the time.
Yes, I do want other people to, or if you have specific examples of how, and both the challenges and the, you know, whatever you have been able to achieve in terms of crossing the ethnic.
Yeah, I mean, I just wanted to echo that point that, I mean, coalition building is definitely happening a lot on our level. You know, when I can pick up the phone and I can call any of these guys and we talk about things and we get our organizations together for different coalitions, but actual, you know, actual dialogue and exchange between populations that speak different languages is hard. It is hard. I mean, we did a forum on immigrant rights last year in Queens, and we worked together with a number of organizations like La Fuente, NICE, New Immigrant Community Empowerment, a whole bunch of different organizations, CPC. So we had this forum that had English speakers, that had Korean speakers, Chinese speakers, Latinos, and we had to have a battery of like interpreters, and then everybody who came up, you know, I mean, it was all supposed to be about testimonials from community members talking directly about how, you know, immigration law was affecting them, and everybody spoke in a different language. And you know, so somebody would be speaking, get really heated, and then nobody knew exactly what they're saying, and then like then the interpreter would translate it, and then everybody would be like, yeah, you know, that'd be great. And so it was difficult. It is difficult to do this actual coalition building on a community level where you have actual community members having this exchange. That's just a point that I thought was really important.
Mm-hmm.
It's important though, and I'm just trying to. we hold a support session in Richmond Hill, and Richmond Hill has Punjabis and Bengalis and Bangladeshis, and of course a West Indian community. And so at our support sessions, I have all these people coming there. And it's so amazing how they assume that violence is always the other. It's kind of like, this only happens with Punjabis because they're such, you know, hot-tempered people. It doesn't happen in my community. We're Buddhists. We don't have this. You know, and it's just, it goes a lot to break down those barriers. And it's so critical. I had a woman who insisted on coming to the Queens Family Justice Center to get services, even though she lives walking distance from the Bronx Family Justice Center, lives in the Bronx, because she wanted to have a familiar face. And it's about educating the communities that we work with that you can go to other people for help. But interpretation is critical, of course. We will help you with interpretation if you need it, but you cannot always just come to Seki where four women in a room, right, help doing the direct services.
Right.
And so I think some of that, bringing them together, no matter how costly, is actually, in terms of interpretation and the awkwardness, it's so important. Because at these support groups, now these women are making intra-community, all South Asian community links. They see each other down the street, and they will know that they are, even though I'm Guyanese and I'm, you know, Punjabi, you know, I'm from India, that we have something to combine together that we can talk about and we can move forward on. And it is important. And I wanted to just say one thing about new, because it's something I'm personally thinking about. I'm a first-generation immigrant. I'm pregnant with my child, I'm pregnant now, and so that child will be a second-generation person, and I'm married to an Indian. I'm of Sri Lankan heritage. What does that look like for tomorrow? Like, Seki was founded by women who were mainly from the old country and came in here with a different political mindset than what I have. And maintaining our relevance and communities that will be intertwined, we were going to intermarry. We're going to maybe not have the language issues, but have different sort of issues.
Right.
Maintaining our relevance is really important to the way the communities are looking in a multi-generational aspect, too. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. No, thank you. Gurpal, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, just
briefly.
Just that whole working, you know, building coalitions around ethnic identity, you know, let's say Asian, you know, I think it's a double-edged sword, right? I can't use that and go organizing in the community with it, right? We're all Asian, come on, you know, come to the meeting. Like, it's not going to really work.
Yeah.
However, you know, putting together a massive Asian, you know, coalition is powerful, you know, and it could have, you know, real political force and capital behind it. So it's, you have to use it, right? And just like your ethnic identity could be used against you, forming sort of a massive Asian coalition under this banner that no one really knows what that means. Am I Asian? I'm really South Asian. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm Afghani. Am I even a part of this? Right? So I think it could definitely be a political tool, and that's all I really see it as, you know, as a political tool, and it could be powerful.
So we need to do that on issues too.
Yeah.
I just want to make a quick comment and then open it up to all of you. And that is, I'm talking about as an old timer, and I don't have any qualms about it, but I have seen things change. I'm not saying completely, but, you know, there is hope that I want to be this optimist. When I started, there was virtually no Pan-Asian thing in New York City. And not to even mention that South Asians, in fact, at that time, we didn't use the word South Asian. So and I'm not talking of 50 years ago. I'm talking only 20 years ago, okay? Mm-hmm. It was very recent. Indians, and I was the only Indian, and I was not considered Asian, period. And I would be knocking at doors, and I would be saying, I want to participate with you, but you are not Asian. I was told every day, you are not Asian. So what I'm saying is, we have come at least some distance. I'm just mentioning this because from the point of view, if you have to think about new, we have to also think about where we have come from, right? Mm-hmm. And where we continue to have these challenges. And I think the good part is that we have people who are fighting these battles every day, you know, and they are, I mean, people like these here, really. They're troopers, and they are like, you know, foot soldiers fighting every day. So, and leaders at the same time. So it's also a question about leadership. Who are the leaders then, right? What kind of leaders can we have? So I just want to, with that, I want to open up. Please introduce yourself and...
about in theory. We have a real activity happening about a week and a half. So what is that about? How do people get involved? What's the process? Why is that important?
I'm just going to say that if you have a question, could you kindly come here and speak in the mic so everyone can hear you? You don't have to repeat it. But
so, that legislative day, I think it's something that Wayne briefly mentioned before. It's for the 12% and growing coalition, which is this coalition that CACF, us, and the Asian American Federation founded, what was it, 2 years ago or about a year and a half ago? And it really is to reflect the fact that, you know, just in a nutshell, Asian Americans are not getting the kinds of resources that we really need, and there are still a ton of services that need to be provided, especially for, like, the grassroots community-based organizations. I mean, one of the reasons why, for example, the Minkwon Center offers the kinds of legal services that we do is because a lot of community members are saying, you know, hey, I don't want to go down to Water Street to talk to a lawyer through a telephone. You know, that doesn't do it for me. So I think that it really highlights the fact that grassroots community-based organizations in the communities in which people live, it's really crucial for those organizations to really be supported and provide these services. So we created this coalition, and we brought together, I think, something more than 50 organizations now, 45 organizations, so we've had this sort of campaign going on all basically for this year, where we've been doing state legislative visits. Now we're sort of focusing on the city level. And it's not just a legislative day. It's actually a big mass rally and an advocacy day. So there's going to be a legislative briefing in the morning. There's going to be a big rally. We're trying to get, you know, 200, 300 people out there for a big rally in around like noontime. And then after that, we've got a whole bunch of legislative visits set up with city council members, with the mayor's administration. So that's, you know, I think this is going to be the real highlight, the real peak of our whole campaign. So it's going to be Tuesday, May 18th. Unfortunately, neither Wayne or myself will be there, but it's going to be a very exciting event.
It was actually scheduled for a different date that ended up competing, and we moved it to when Steve and I are both on vacation.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, Seema has some to respond.
I just also, you know, this gives me an opportunity to plug National Capacity, is an organization that I'm on the board of. We've been around for about 10 years, and we have a program called Community in the Capital, which it's too late to apply this year, but next year you should think about it if you're interested in this work, where we bring community-based organization staff to D.C. to meet with elected officials, and there's a whole week-long training that happens beforehand. And so I would encourage all of you to look at that as an opportunity to get involved as well.
Sandra has something to say. Sandra, could you come here? I'm sorry, but you know, I want everyone to. If you're ready to ask a question, please come here.
It's actually not a question, but I want to follow up on something that Wayne said that I feel is very important, is that I'm Sandra Oh, and I work for the New York City Comptroller currently, and I have worked for also another Asian elected official and a non-Asian elected official. I think it's very important, as Wayne pointed out, that you can't count on the three Asian elected officials here to carry out what we need. And I think one of the challenges, especially I see of community groups and grassroots groups, is that I've seen a lot of invitations sent. For example, I used to work for the previous controller, William Thompson, and they say, come to our dinner, do all this stuff. But I think one of the challenges is that we don't get past that photo moment. Like, he would go to dinner, they would take a picture, and that's it. I don't get any other letters from other groups saying, this is what we need, this is what our community is about. We don't hold them accountable or responsible for any of our needs. And I think this is something that, as a community, we need to get beyond, I call it the photo moment.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. My name is Ed Ma. I'm a committee board too. And I appreciate the panel. You know, I learned a lot. And I appreciate, especially Wayne, you know, doing the coalition, terrific job for us, really getting between the community and the mainstream. I appreciate his coalition. And also appreciate the panel. Actually, the title is the leader in the leadership. Actually, they're talking also grassroots strategy. I'm glad you mentioned focus, you know, why the new challenge, the more focus, the new America. Yes, okay. And specifically for Julie Huang, your mention about the legislature, I myself, you know, And I just myself, I wrote a legislative proposal to former councilman Alan Gerson. The reason why I'm very, very enriched by almost 15 or 20 years joining the community work, and the first about the closing, MTA closing the D-Train Express without notified community, and then land rezoning or without notified China community. The third one, Chansung Square in Chinatown, also without notified. I was so enriched by repeatedly the government action toward Chinatown. So I use these three examples, made Leslie talk with Alan Gerson, and he said, go ahead. So I wrote the proposal last August, and October 8th, and I testify chaired by John Liu. At that time, he was the chair of the Transportation Committee. So finally, the law passed the public the mandatory public hearing advance notification, because the current law, there's no law. If they want to notify street project tomorrow or next week, you have to come. You don't come, you lost. Now, I propose for 4 months and six Q&A committee meetings. You know, that's too dream, too wishful thinking. Finally, you know, they only negotiate with the Speaker Queen's office. Finally, only 2 weeks. I was so mad. I said, forget it. I don't want to do anything. And, yes. And
the, have a question or a comment?
Yes. I think this is why the legislating. What we are doing is just voting and the legislation. The only thing we do legislation, we are not only government legislation regulate community behavior, human behavior, resident behavior. We, Asian community, should legislate law to regulate government legislation. And thank Julie Wong has done a lot, you know, for this in the community mention about. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ma.
And I am at Queen's College, and, you know, the populations we are talking about are our students, really. You know, we're talking about the communities, first-gen immigrants and the children are our students, really. So about youth, I just wanted to say about, like, you know, how do we take it to the youth as well? Is this question, your question related to what we are asking? Okay, so why don't you?
I'm like, went through this whole grassroots organizing in the 70s. I'm now a videographer, freelancing. I've been trying to be an artist forever. But in order to support myself as a freelance, I mean, as an artist, I've worked in the industry. And to talk about gerrymandering, I've worked in this stockbroker's company, and the CEO there said, my great-grandfather invented or discovered gerrymandering from the South. Blue chip, all he would talk to would be the blue chip millionaires to invest. And I forgot what the stockbroking company was, but that's where you have to start to change. I mean, the changes are from the generation established in America for so long. I mean, for myself, I found that my great-grandfather, I worked on the railroad. But for me, I've worked in different areas, especially in the American Museum of Natural History. And there is a glass ceiling existence. For first generation, it might not exist. But for other generations, it has been going on for a long time. So for me to start over as grassroots organizing, I find it totally resistant, because I've been able to interview Margaret Chen 15 years ago of why she had failed the first city council voting, and now it takes endurance, persistence, and resistance to continue up the ladder in the political arena. But yeah, about the glass ceiling situation and where I can get my support, even though I've gone through the social justice system.
Great, thank you so much. So, here, if you want, you have a bunch of comments and questions, if you could respond to it briefly, please.
The 18 and 29-year-olds, you know, in Seva, that's the fastest-growing sort of body in our organization is that age, with the 18 and 29-year-olds. I'm shocked at how many new members we get through Facebook, through other means. We started with about 15 youth members, just because it happened organically in the neighborhood, not because we were like trying to create a youth division, but now we have over 150 that are very consistent in showing up to things, and yeah. It's for some reason the fastest growing part of our organization as far as membership is concerned. And it's, you know, there's no real science behind it, right? It's art. It's pure art. And how do you get the youth engaged? And we do everything from basketball tournaments to, you know, we help them get jobs with the Census Bureau, we have them going out, you know, creating sort of little competitions of who can knock on the most doors, and they really respond to a lot of different things. And so it's pure art, and, you know, it's about finding the right kids who have a network, you know, and they bring in others. So, I mean, mm-hmm. I have them. They need work, so you know, you can reach out to us, and if you have anything, you know, we have tons of them ready to go.
Great, thanks. I would like
people
to respond.
I mean, young people not voting is not just an Asian thing.
Yeah.
Just
generally.
I mean, it cuts across racial groups, mm-hmm. and it's no shock that older people vote more often. Yes, am I concerned that Asian American youth aren't as more politically involved? Yeah, there's no doubt about that. And is it good to have organizations like these in order to try and get them involved? Like, yes, that's definitely true. But I think that's where we go, when we go back to this issue of, is there a new Asian American? Like, we have to look at who's really voting. And it's really older generation folks across all racial groups are the ones who are voting. So if we're going to do some political education, it's not just about getting new voters in there who hopefully are younger, but I think it's also about political education and consciousness raising and community building for the Asian American community across all age sectors.
I think the education component is so important, plus the empowerment aspect of it. Like, this is the situation. You don't like what you see. You want to prevent something. You want to do something. This is what you can do. This is a real avenue for you to take an active stand in changing what you don't like about your community or what you see. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the youth, not just the youth, a lot of everyone I work with, don't understand that if they think the system is flawed, what do they do about it? They just kind of go along with the ride. And it's about educating them to be like, you don't like the criminal justice response to when you call 911. This is what you can do. Why don't you? And it's working with them so that they can express that agency, because a lot of times they've been cultivated, or they've gotten the runaround so many times that they feel like they can't actually have a vocal voice, a powerful voice. So it's the education plus the do something. You can actually make a change. And then vesting them in the issue, in the organization, in the even in the candidate, if that's what it means, to catalyze that into advocacy.
Well, you know, my experience over the last year with our youth group, and it's only been a year. I'm not an educator. I don't even like kids that much. But, you know, really. And so I was just like, I don't want to do this. But my experience over the last year has been, you have to really trick them. You have to trick them. You can't tell them, we're going to come and, you know, come to our meeting. We're going to empower you and teach you about issues. No one's showing up. No one's showing up. You know, you talk about free pizza, and you talk about other things. You know, you talk about organizing, you know, a basketball tournament. They show up. So, if you try to do direct organizing around issues with the youth, it doesn't work, and it hasn't worked. The only thing that's worked with us is if, you know, we have them, we bring them into a room and let them talk about things. You know, let them talk about their issues and sort of say, oh, really, you know, there's no sports things going on in the neighborhood, well, why don't you organize them? And this is what happened last year with us. We organized a tournament in the local park, and all the kids complained about how sort of messed up the courts were, potholes and this and that. And a local elected official came to the tournament, and I said, tell him. And he promised them that he would repave that whole court. And I think that kind of, you know, that kind of interaction is what they realized was like, oh, wow, that's easy, you know. And so it wasn't direct, you know. And as soon as you try to invite them over about training them about issues, you know, it hasn't happened.
You have to,
you
bribe
have
them.
To lie to them and
you
trick
have to bribe
them.
Okay,
you
know, okay.
Gurpal, you're way too young to be cynical like that.
So Steve and Seema. Okay, Steve and Seema. Not that I mean, love to have panelists talk to each other, but Steve and Seema.
I mean, I feel like you can organize youth around issues, and you can get them fired up about, you know, community issues. I mean, our youth program, it's always embarrassing because our youth program always out-organizes and out-mobilizes our adult organizing stuff. So they have conferences on the DREAM Act. They have they go out for mobilizations on student Metro card cuts. And, you know, I feel like, you know, the youth that we work with, you know, if you really take time, and it takes a ton of time, and it's hard, and, you know, but I don't know if you have to trick them. I think that you talk to them, and I feel like if you're able to tap into the enthusiasm and the passion they have, you know, they'll be into it. You don't have to trick them with, you know, fake basketball tournaments and things like that.
Well, no, it's a real basketball.
Real basketball.
I think Steve addressed a few things, but I agree that you do not need to trick them. we've engaged. I think our youth. We have a summer youth program. We don't necessarily have a year-round youth program, but I think working with youth, part of it is listening, right? We're so used to just like telling young people how things should be done, and I think that, you know, Chaya has been built on its youth organizers in many ways. We've accomplished a lot of the most effective organizing and engagement with youth because, one, we're able to cover a lot more languages if we have 10 youth, so there's just a practical level of that. But also, they are living in the communities that we're working in, and they are actually frustrated at their parents' lack of engagement sometimes. Mm-hmm. And so I think they actually are the key to mobilizing in many ways. And so, you know, the needs assessments that we've done, we usually do a lot of surveying, and have the youth lead that effort, and they're great at it, and they enjoy it, actually. So I think...
And they learn so much out of it.
Yeah, I think so.
Unfortunately, we have to close. Does you want to say something? So can I just go to the panel for a minute or two, and if you want to say something that you have wanted to say here and you didn't get a chance?
I wanted to just quickly address Jennifer's comment question, which I've been thinking about, and now my brain kind of hurts because it was definitely very complicated. I feel like I'm back in grad school. But, I talked a little bit before about the sort of first generation, second generation mindset and this idea that I didn't want to I think it's important to say that this is not the mindset of first generation people. I think it's much more complicated. In fact, I would say that second generation folks respond much better to this ethnic argument, like we need to get a Korean American elected. You know, like I saw PJ Kim running down in District 1, Kevin Kim running in District 19, and there were tons of young second generation Korean Americans who were so worked up and excited about getting a Korean person on city council. And I feel like, of course, there are some first-generation, you know, older immigrants who felt that same way. But I feel like in a lot of ways it really struck a chord with second-generation folks, and which I don't think you would think of. So I think the picture is a lot more complicated. And I think for first-generation folks, they're having to deal with a lot of these issues and policies and practices on a day-to-day level, like language access. For second-generation folks, that really isn't that much of an issue. But for first-generation folks, I mean, it's an issue in the sense that their parents have to go through it, right? But I think for first-generation folks, language access is something they deal with on a day-to-day basis. And so I think the picture is more complicated than simply, saying, oh, first-generation people respond to this ethnic argument and second-generation people think about policies. I don't think it's like that. So I think it's much more complicated. So that's just one thing I want to say.
Okay.
I would just like to put out there that as much as that we as an Asian American community need to come together more often and collaborate more often and work together across generations, across ethnic groups, across like the different immigration histories that we have, I think it's also important for us to work with other communities of color. As much as I'd like to think that the fact that we're the fastest growing group in New York and we're 12% of the population, that's a really influential thing, that still means there's 88% of the population that's not us. And these are the people that we need to work with. And I think part of it is strategic, and I think part of it is ideological. That if we're all interested in improving the well-being of 8.2 million New Yorkers, we need to build these ties. And I think a lot of times we have to be critical of ourselves. We're always saying, stop treating us like the perpetual foreigner. Stop treating us like the perpetual foreigner. And then I did it today where, like, I was like, oh, 78% of us are foreign-born, and we have language access needs, and we're all immigrants, and we have these things and that. Like, we do it ourselves.
Yeah.
So I think what I'm getting at is that being critical of ourselves is also, are there stances we take that end up perpetuating these separations among communities of color? When I feel like whenever there's immigrant rights arguments going on, everyone always tosses out, everyone in the United States are immigrants. Like, no, that's not true. There are Native Americans. They got annihilated, but they're still here. So if we want to build ties for comprehensive immigration reform, how do we work with African American communities? How do we work with Native American communities so we don't get separated as community members? So I think that's where I just like to leave people as, like, if we're talking about the new Asian American, it's not just being about an Asian American. It's also about being a part of a community of color with others.
Thanks. Tiloma and...
I yield to Wayne. Whatever he said, I appropriate by reference.
Yeah.
These are closing remarks. So
I think it's an appropriate point to end right there. That's
okay. Great. Thank you.
I'm going to take the mic because I can. No. I have to tell you, I'm a fourth generation of my family in the United States. My children are fifth generation Chinese Americans. And I am part of the old guard, as they say, grew up during the civil rights movement and so on. And I am so happy to see the baton being passed, and I'm so happy to see a panel of young leaders who are willing to take that baton and to do the organizing in their own way, in their own style, because clearly times have changed. The way that we approach our communities has changed. And what they are doing, in fact, is bridging for us in many ways that our generation couldn't bridge. They also happen to be extremely privileged in terms of education, in terms of the ability to communicate and articulate, something which the older generation could not do as easily. They are also extremely privileged because they're living in a society where there is a critical mass. In the old days, when only 105 Chinese were allowed to immigrate to the United States each year, critical mass could not be had, let alone day-to-day survival. So, as they have these privileges, they also have these responsibilities. And again, as proud as I am of people like John Liu, I am also extremely proud of this generation. Thank you so much for all of your work.